very respected Guruji, respected Bhanudi, respected speakers on the dais, dignitaries on the dais, my very, very worthy and learned and distinguished guests, both men and women from all over the world who are part of this very august gathering. I'm truly privileged and honored by this opportunity to be a part of this very important conference, and even more privileged to be in the august presence and to share a dais with Guru Sri Ravi Shankar. To say I'm awestruck to be on the same dais and to have to speak in his presence of Revered Guruji, who has inspired me for over a decade, restored spiritual balance in my mind through difficult times, especially in my current posting, and restored my faith in the adage that there can be peace only if there is justice, is something that I am so eternally grateful for. Guruji has also endorsed my belief in the process of mediation, the process of and importance of engaging with youth, ethics in public life, necessity of universal education, the need for protection and care for the environment, and the importance of hard work, humility, and forgiveness in our daily lives. Each one of these qualities and necessities is so essential in my role as a judge. I express my deep and abounding gratitude to Guruji and the Art of Living for all that they have contributed to my life, and most especially for giving me this opportunity of standing here before you. This session is titled The Passion, Passion, the Seed of Continuum. Before I start, I must acknowledge the contribution of all the women who have come into the world before me and spoken before me. Today, I stand on the shoulders of thousands of women who have acted and contributed to the cause of the women in their own little ways. Their efforts have enabled me to reach a position where I can take the cause that they espoused a little further. Much has been said about the position of women in Nepal, in India, by the speakers before me, and I echo exactly what they have said. Therefore, at the outset, my thanks to all those brave women also who have stood here before me. Gandhiji has said, a burning passion coupled with absolute detachment is the key to all success. These words allude to one of the core teachings also of the Bhagavad Gita, and in general are relevant for all human action. Gandhiji has required this detachment to be coupled with a burning passion. What is this burning passion? How can a judge find it? How must a judge define it so that it may sustain her daily work? I personally am of the belief that you cannot speak on passion as divorced from either compassion or dispassion so far as judging is concerned. So far as judging is concerned, the three are inextricably intertwined. A judge is required to be fair. And you can be fair only if you're able to firstly to recognize and rise about all those biases and prejudices which you grow up with, which are inherent in each one of us as a human being, as a member of a family, as a member of the community and society. And then the judge has to dispassionately evaluate the facts which are placed before him or her and base a fair judgment thereon. The central argument of what I'm going to say today is that it is passion for individual rights that not only sustains a judge's work, but also provides the necessary compassion to navigate the convoluted terrain of laws, and in our country, even of customs, personal religious laws and beliefs in India. It is that which allows a judge to be dispassionately passionate while also being just and fair. I'm restricting what I'm saying to you to really address what the value of these three essential qualities is in my role as, or in the role of any person as a judge. A few words upon my personal story. As a first generation lawyer in the Delhi High Court and a woman, the journey to the bar and then the bench was for me neither conventional nor expected. My parents were both academics. When I joined the bar as a first-generation lawyer, I had not the slightest expectation to join the bench. And it was almost a war that you had to rage, being amongst the few women who practice in the Delhi High Court. After 23 years of practice as a lawyer, when I was invited to the bench, which was to my utmost surprise, I was aware that my role at the bench was going to be even more challenging. I was now reading the law, no more for only for someone I represented. Now I was speaking to the masses through my judgments and orders. I was to serve as the interface between the law and the litigant before me. I wanted to speak to every woman and man in the street. And in this endeavor, I've drawn in from something amazing that Mother Teresa said. She had said, and I quote, "If I look at the mass, I will never act. If I look at the one, I will," unquote. In delivering justice for the masses, I knew I had to invoke every bit of law, national and international, yet not lose the sight of the one before me. Because, it is said, the law, after all, is born from the despair of human nature. It was so said by the renowned Spanish philosopher and thinker Gasset. It should thus never abandon the litigant before it, while maintaining a broad dispassion, a detachment necessary to remain the objective, one should remain passionately sensitive and responsive. So how do I achieve this? What I have learned is that though standing on the shoulders of the giants is valuable, that is the law, the precedents that guide your view, it is even more important to step right into the shoes of people and walk the town in them to catch a glimpse of their lived experiences. In other words, I decide a case for a litigant, where I become the litigant. In a world where women and the weak are increasingly disenfranchised, their voices muzzled, and their experiences obliterated, it is imperative that those who do have a voice and the power to raise it become audible and make sure they are heard. Amongst the marginalized, I have found clearly there's a disproportionate share of suffering that is reserved for women across the board and across ages. But it is events such as this that gives me hope. Our presence today, the presence of all the learned and honorable men and women in this room today, signifies that all of us have cut across at least some of the shackles that continue to strap thousands and hundreds of women all over the world, and now it is incumbent on us to pull the others up too. To the several people who have told me that I've broken the proverbial glass ceiling, I have said, no, it gets broken only when I lift others, especially other women, and take them up with me. And this is something which has been echoed by all the speakers before me, whether it was Simranjit ji, whether it was Kiran ji, or whether it was my very dear friend Sapna. Let me share with you my daily prayer before I sit on the bench. Before sitting in court every day, I pray to God that don't let anyone leave my court with a sense that he or she has not been heard. I am not infallible. I can make mistakes in my judging, but certainly nobody should have a grievance that his or her voice has not been heard in my courtroom. A few words on what is the role of compassion in the role of a judge. Compassion requires us to step into the shoes of the hapless, the person who looks at the law, and to salvage her faith or his faith in the system. As a judge, it is not infrequently that I have had to do this salvaging for victims of grave injustices, for them to see hope at the end of a tunnel. You know, I'll just summarize some of the areas, some of the occasions, instances that I have had to exercise these roles and use these, both the role of a passionate judge with compassion, exercising dispassion. It's each one is a story in itself. But, you know, I have found that we very loosely use the expression access to justice as being the only, as access to courts synonymously as access to justice. It is not so. Access to courts is only one of the means of accessing justice. Justice is an expression equality is an expression, fraternity is an expression, none of which have been defined in any law. So what may seem just to one person seems rank injustice to the other. In every litigation, there are two parties. The person who gets the order in his or her favor says justice is done. Invariably, the other feels injustice has been done. And it is my experience, especially in our country, I have already observed that women are treated disproportionately, you know, have to face a more disproportionately unfair and difficult situation because of their peculiar positions. You know, the barriers which arise in accessing justice are not only ability to reach the court, but they include social barriers, fear of ostracization, stigmatization, you know, geographical barriers, illiteracy, ignorance and fear of the law, fear of institutions, and many, many, many others. So, you know, it is not so easy for any person who is placed in a difficult or a marginalized situation to reach or access the courts. And some of the barriers which I've actually had to rule on include a barrier imposed by those doorkeepers to the courtroom, physical barriers. On account of security concerns, rules are put in several courts. In Delhi High Court, an entry pass regime was introduced that a person who wanted to enter the courtroom needed an entry pass. What was put in the rules was that you needed photo identity. Now, courts are meant to be transparent places open to all. Any law student, any school child, anybody should be able to get into the court. The requirement of putting in a photo identity completely shut the doors for a rickshaw puller who had to reach my courtroom. He came from a small town in Uttar Pradesh and had no identification, no photo identity. And in a case in which he had to appear, he was not being able to appear. So this was where a physical access is a requirement of security, provides a physical barrier. Then the requirement of an entry fee, court fee, it was enhanced to 400 times in Delhi. And what I was required to consider was whether you could say that access to the courts was or justice was a marketable commodity. And in this case, I had occasion to rule on the disproportionate impact of a court fee requirement on women, especially a woman, say, who was looking for maintenance for her husband, because the suit valuation required to be 10 times her claim of maintenance. So where would somebody who had not been able to work because she was a homemaker or was looking after her children find the financial resources to fight against her own husband to come to court? So this was where court fee was an entry fee barrier. Legislative vacuum. We are all hearing of the Me Too movement. And when I went to Jammu and Kashmir, I had a case where somebody had set up an employment agency and he was exploiting young girls on the rules that he would get them employed. So two of these young girls from Baramulla summoned the courage to go and file a case for rape, complaining of rape. And in this case, while disposing of the matter, the employer, this agency owner, had come to the court dismissing his case. The court had directed the government to look at schemes for women, etc. When I went on to the bench in Jammu and Kashmir, I had examined the matter and looked at international jurisprudence. The International Association of Women Judges has encapsulated the whole difficulty of women where men in authority exploit them, sexually exploit them, using the authority of, say, issuing a passport, giving them a pass to cross the border, or passing them clearing their exams, or clearing their PhD doctorates. So this was termed as sextortion, you know, using sex to extort a favor against this. So I had ruled on this and directed the government to frame a law, and sextortion was made an offense only in Jammu and Kashmir. It was not an offense. It has never been an offense in any other part of the world. So unfair legislation, you know, we have all in most of the states in India, begging is criminalized. The act of begging, asking for alms, is a criminal offense. Now, this is culturally and traditionally very incorrect. And how can you say that somebody who merely says, talks of his plight, that I am helpless, I have no means of income, I don't have food to eat, I am dying, please help me. What is the offense in that? So I had two occasions to decide the legality and the constitutionality of this legislation. And while in Delhi, I had struck down the law as applicable to the begging in Delhi, and thereafter also in Kashmir. You have also disability as a barrier to accessing justice. On this, the government of Delhi had said that only 10% of the local transport needs to be enabling the specially abled people, and the buses acquisition would be only 10% enabled. So I had also ruled on this that you cannot do this. You have to provide a universally enabled environment to ensure the rights of the disabled. So we have also had areas, you just heard the mention of the vulnerable witness deposition complex. This relates to preventing an interface between the perpetrator of a sexual offense and the victim. We are aware that victims of sexual violence feel extremely thwarted in seeking justice because the act of recounting works on a secondary traumatization. It is horrible to have to relive again and again your ordeal as you've gone through. So we have set up this facility in Delhi. I began this in 2012 and carried it to Jammu and Kashmir. And the principle was that uniformly identical procedures in all matters may be working a lot of injustice. So I have also had occasion to examine the plight of a victim of the partner in an honor killing. You know, the boy partner is killed by the family of the girl because they belong to a different caste or a different economic status. You know, we treat the family of the boy as victims and entitled to compensation. In the very famous murder in Delhi, in the Nitish Katara murder case, some very powerful important politician was involved in the act of murder. The girl came from that family. And I had occasion to examine the rights of the girl in this partnership and had ruled that compensation, that such women also were entitled to a fair treatment and be treated as victims and compensation. So, you know, now all this is possible, all this adjudication is possible because Sapna has said so, now you build in a passion. Kiranji said you realize you have a passion, but when you go to the bench, what is your passion going to be? The passion which a judge has to develop, if not there, or to at least recognize, is a passion to ensure rights. And you can ensure rights only if you have a spirit of compassion. Justice Krishna Iyer is an extremely well-known judge, and he had said, a judge's heart must bleed. But then each one of us, it is well said, we all grew up with taking the values of our family, what our schools teach us, and whatever we have grown with, our experiences. As Kiranji said, her experience, her first experience and encounter with injustice taught her to realize the passion that she had for ensuring that there will be no injustice. But then this passion treats people with a compassion, which in me is ensuring a hearing to everybody. But at the same time, you have to realize all the prejudices and biases you have grown with, which are inherent in each one of us, and keep those biases aside. And that is acting dispassionately. So passion, compassion, and dispassion are absolutely imperative and integral requirements of every effort that any or every judge in any part of the world must have. So I am so grateful to Guruji and Bhanuji and the Art of Living Foundation for having given me a chance to dwell on this aspect of my daily work as a judge and make me realize that this is actually the way I'm working and what I can summarize in. You know, the conventional view of judges is as ivory tower recluses has been debunked by the increased engagement with public on occasions such as today. Judges no more speak only through their judgments. They are participants as well as stakeholders in the society. Remoteness and its symbolic impartiality no more hold true. In a recent public address by the Right Honorable Beverly McLachlan, the first woman Chief Justice of Canada, she said, "People are entitled to know who their judges are," unquote. While we move towards a more meaningful conversations today and further on, we still judges primarily talk through their judgments. What we say does not offset what we do. One may talk endlessly on how compassion must inform our lives, but the same, I believe, is rendered meaninglessly if our judgments do not echo the same compassion in the lives that they touch. In a system that bends unduly towards some, reserves disproportionate misery for the rest, it is the victim of the structural inequalities that we speak to. What all these victims need above all is to know that they are not alone, that we are not forgetting them. And compassion, to some extent, can help overcome their invisibilization. Passion, thus, is an integral part of compassion in the very construction of the expression. A judge is complete only if she has the passion to ascertain rights as well as to ensure them with compassion, all the time acting objectively and dispassionately, that is free of personal biases and prejudices. I will end here with a word of not only gratitude again, but also congratulations for the beautiful conceptualization of the entire program. I must also express my very extreme gratitude to the warmth with which we have been treated. I arrived here at 11 last night to be told that my bags had not reached Bangalore. And the grace and the attention which I have received from all the volunteers who ensured some alternate clothing and told me that I should go to bed because I have to speak in the morning, while they stayed awake till must be 3 a.m. in the morning when the bag finally reached, is something that I will never ever forget. The warmth of the hospitality and the extreme levels, Guruji, to which the volunteers have carried the spirit of Art of Living and the selflessness is incredible. You know, I am a huge lover of the environment and the plants, and the care which I have seen in the few hours that I've spent here, you know, I'm going back so enriched and with the firm resolve that I'm going to be here very often and for much longer. So thank you very, very much to Guruji, to Bhanuji, and all the beautiful people who are present here and are part of this wonderful organization. Thank you.